BBOR, Black Box Online Radio, coming to you from West Virginia, Black Box Ned 88 on Instagram TV for the bonus podcast. And today we're going to be talking all about the murder of Elise Paler. This is a case that we have mentioned on the channel before. We have two previous segments on Elise Paler. The first one was a direct response to the Netflix show Killer Kids, or that's where I watched it on Netflix. And the second one was a direct response to the show The First Degree, which is actually the first episode I ever heard from The First Degree, and I became a regular listener to that podcast, available on podcast1.com. But we had a comment coming in on the first upload that we did about Elise Paler, and giving a shout-out to YouTube user Erica Nahara, who said, "It would be nice to have heard more about the case, and not only about the psychologist in Killer Kids." So, I think that is an excellent idea, and that's what we're going to be doing today. We're going to be talking all about the murder of Elise Paler, and we're not doing any type of response to anyone else's channel or anyone else's content. We're just going to be going through some of the material associated with the murder of Elise Paler, and to do that, we have to go back to 1995, very specifically, July 22nd of that year. And I'd like to give a big shout out to sfgate.com for providing some of the source material. Let's have a read. On July 22, 1995, Elise Marie Paler, age 15, would be the latest victim of a city burning with hate. That night, she was at home watching TV with her family when she got a call from a friend. It was a group of boys she knew. They said they wanted to smoke some marijuana and to see if she wanted to meet up with them. She told her parents she was going to bed, but instead she snuck out. Elise, along with Jacob DeLashmut, Royce Casey, and Joe Fiorella, made their way to a eucalyptus grove nearby to sit and smoke some pot. That's the introduction. Then what would happen is Elise Paler would be choked with a belt and stabbed 12 times. The cause of death was bleeding, but none of the stab wounds were completely lethal, meaning that she bled to death very, very slowly. The three individuals there, Royce Casey, Jacob DeLashmut, and Joe Fiorella, would proceed to rape Elise. They raped her while she was alive, as well as post-mortem. And it was actually not until 1996, 8 months later, that Elise's remains were discovered in the eucalyptus grove. During the initial weeks after this incident took place, these three boys, Royce, Jacob, and Joe, would come back to the area where Elise's remains were hidden, and they would have sex with her corpse. Once again, necrophilia. What was the motivation for this? Well, this case would go on to take the nation by storm, not only because of the severe and heinous nature of the way these teenagers were acting, but they would claim that one of the primary motivations was music, and that was something that would come to challenge free speech laws, creative and free expression laws. What on earth would we have to say about all this? So the first thing to say is, the way that people found out about this is one of the individuals, Royce Casey, developed somewhat of a guilty conscience, and he began to become overwhelmed with guilt. So then what happened is he first converted to Christianity, and prior to this, the boys were heavily involved with, you could say, practicing Satanism, but I don't necessarily know how deep they were involved with that. But definitely prior to the murder of Elise Paler, Royce Casey would first convert to Christianity, trying to clear his conscience, but he's still overwhelmed with the feelings of guilt. And during this eight month time period, Royce would eventually become estranged from Joe Fiorella and Jacob DeLashmut, and he was the first one to go to the police, and then that started the cycle of the legal proceedings, as well as the formal investigation and the discovery of Elise Paler's body. By all accounts, it appears that Joe Fiorella was the ringleader of the group. But these boys were involved in a metal band, and they claimed that Slayer was a very large influence about why they chose to commit this crime. And not only was it Slayer, but also they were definitely involved with just trying to learn more about Satanism, occult practices. They wanted to have any sort of fascination with that type of darker side. And actually, let's have a little bit more of a read here. Paler's killing had been plotted once before, Royce Casey said. Fiorella and DeLashbit and another teenager had nearly carried out a plan to kill Elise Paler, according to Royce Casey. In a plot similar to that which led to the girl's death, Royce Casey told investigators that the trio enticed Elise Paler from her rural Arroyo Grande home and walked to a spot on the Mesa, and we're all, of course, in California, where there was a steep ravine. One of the boys pretended to slip down the ravine as a ruse to get Paler to the bottom, the investigator said when he was told. Fiorella then tossed Williams a knife, the same knife that was used in her killing. The other teen, however, just stood there. Casey told the investigator where Fiorella and DeLashmet were both saying, do it, do it, do it. So another person's involved. There was even one plot to launch an attack on Elise Paler that was unsuccessful. But Elise Paler's response to that was she thought that this was just some type of bizarre humor or something, because no one went through with anything at that point. So she met up with them at a later date, and then that led to her murder. Now, is there any real connection with music in this? You will hear a lot of different things about the case of Elise Paler and the murder and the motivation for this. In some, you will simply hear that Slayer was saying things about how you need to find a blonde-haired, blue-eyed girl such as Elise Paler was, and she needs to be sacrificed. And you also hear other things about how it is alleged that the boys genuinely believed that committing this murder would give them some type of power. Or, I mean, you will hear different things. Like, one of the reports says that they would simply become better musicians by getting powers from Satan. But another one is really quite clear that they thought they could enter into hell and meet Satan himself. I first heard about this case when I was watching a talk show back in the 1990s. And then what they were saying was that Elise Paler's own father was saying that the boys genuinely believed that they could enter into hell, and that by committing this murder, they would get a chance to interact with Satan, and that they could become the biggest band in hell. So you're going to hear some different things about this. And I did find a few quotations on the internet that did support what the father was saying, that first and foremost, yes, they believed that, or they said that they wanted to commit this murder to get musical abilities. But then there is a quote, I believe it's actually from Jacob DeLashmut, that says something about they wanted to enter into hell and to interact with Satan. Did the boys believe any of this? Did these teenagers actually believe that by committing this type of destructive ritual that they were going to obtain powers from Satan? Highly unlikely, because another thing that came out later on was that the ringleader was Joseph Fiorella. And Royce Casey also said very clearly, you can find this on Wikipedia even, but I found it in an article from Medium.com that I was reading through, which was provided as the source material, that the real motivation for this was simply a case of obsession as well as sexual domination. Domination is one of the greatest forms of motivation for people to commit these types of murders. I want to be with this person. This person doesn't want to be with me. So that leads to a destructive action such as rape or murder. It is horribly wrong. It is absolutely heinous. But the other two boys seem really quite clear that Joe Fiorella, the ringleader of the group, developed an unhealthy obsession with Elise Paler, and he wanted to have her. And if he couldn't have her in a conventional way, he wanted to destroy her. Now, when it comes to the response that came from some of the people that knew these three boys, in an article as well from SanFranciscoGate.com, we have someone named Andrew Watt, who was a personal friend of Royce Casey. And let's hear what he has to say here. Andrew Watt, age 20, knew one of the accused killers. It shocked the S-dash-dash out of me. I think we can say it. It shocked the shit out of me, said Watt. Me and him were pretty good friends. He was a calm, mellow dude, especially compared to Joe Fiorella and Jacob DeLashmut. But one of the things that we should say about this is the shocking thing about Royce Casey being a perpetrator in this incident is really quite clear. It is that he is the first one who develops the guilty conscience. And as we said, first he converted to Christianity and then he alerted the police. But Andrew Watts said that the Arroyo Grande area became progressively weirder over the years. Too many hard drugs. Pot is one thing, but we're talking about crack and crystal meth, lots of it. Elise Paler was stabbed and strangled to death on July 22, 1995. Her body was not found for 8 months, and only then because one of the killers came forward, and as we heard, that was Royce Casey. I mentioned that we had some previous segments about the murder of Elise Paler on this channel. If you could put the first segment into one sentence, what I would say is, though, about any of these motivations, music, drugs, any of those things, you could put it into one sentence and just say, if somebody is to commit a crime like this and then blame it on music, that is unacceptable. Someone has to have a pre-existing mental condition before they are going to commit a crime like this. So, I mean, it is an unacceptable defense to try and blame this on the music industry, even if there are these types of material found in death metal music. Now, there's something that we should say about that, about the responsibility of the music industry, because they talk about this in the book Lords of Chaos. We even did some discussions about their material in a variety of different ways. Lords of Chaos is a book about the satanic metal underground, but it just becomes a commentary on life and everything. So the thing to say about that is, first and foremost, it's like, are musicians responsible if they are making direct claims to violence? I mean, if they're talking about very violent content in their music, do they have any responsibility for what the people do, what their audience does? What do people like Royce Casey and Jacob DeLashman and Joe Fiorella end up doing? Like, is the band responsible? And the songs that are like in question from Slayer are called Altar of Sacrifice, and it talks about the high priest awaiting the dagger in hand, spilling the pure virgin blood. She had blonde hair and blue eyes, and she was a virgin, and she'd be a perfect sacrifice for the devil, the ultimate sin against God, the ticket to hell. And some of the things we talked about, as we mentioned, Elise Paler's father saying that the boys wanted to enter hell and get powers from Satan. If they're putting this type of content out there, or should they even be held responsible? And the simple answer and response to that is just that, well, no, because as I understand it, the law is about preventing calls to immediate violence. If it says something like, pick up the dagger and cut her throat or stab her or something like that, that is not a call to immediate violence. Number one, people are expected to be able to differentiate between fantasy and reality. That is just one of the ways that the law seems to function when they are simply saying that people have to have these types of awareness in place. These barriers need to be already drawn when someone has the ability to differentiate between fantasy and reality. So if somebody's talking about, you even heard it there, they're saying that the high priestess is doing it. Did it ever say, hey, you need to go out and do this? And even if it did, what I understand about speech that is not protected is if the band were telling people you need to do this to a specific person, or that you need to go out and commit a violent act on this date and time, those would be calls to immediate violence. And the band Slayer was found not liable for this because they very simply just said they didn't make any calls for immediate violence. They didn't tell these boys to do any specific actions. They're musicians. They're putting out material that is going to be listened to by a wide variety of individuals. And they certainly aren't making any direct calls, threats, or any types of actions in that way. So that's just my understanding of how how free speech and expression laws work. Okay, now I'd actually like to go over to a publication from the San Luis Obispo. They did a lot of things about the murder of Elise Paler, and if you ever do some reading up on this, you might find some quotations from this publication, San Luis. I've never heard of this word before, obispo.com. But once again, their material was shared across the internet in a variety of ways. Talking about the murder of Elise Paler, the killing started when Jacob DeLashma strangled her with a belt that he slipped from his waist. Royce Casey held her down while Joe Fiorella pulled a hunting knife from a sheath and started plunging it into the girl's neck. It was DeLashma's turn next, and then Casey's. A forensic pathologist who performed an autopsy on the girl's body concluded that she was stabbed 12 times. None of the individual wounds were fatal, and that meant that she slowly bled to death. Casey told investigators that Elise Paler cried out for her mother while she was being attacked. She was on the ground praying to God and calling for her mom. After she bled to death, they raped her corpse. Casey said he, Fiorella, and DeLashman plotted Elise Paler's slaying for more than a month, talking about it often and while playing death metal in the band they called Hatred. The band styled after the group Slayer, whose albums feature lyrics about the devil and sacrificing virgins. Once again, did they ever say anything about, hey, you three boys, you need to go out and do this? No. So, I mean, it's very difficult to try and blame the music on things when there's no immediate call to action. Fiorella, according to Casey, had several books on Satanism. And that's another thing that I read about Joe Fiorella. I'm not sure the exact publication on that one, but it might have even been about Royce Casey, too, that they became really involved with the collecting of books in regard to Satanism and the occult. And just they would get anything they could get their hands on, they wanted to be in the possession of. And what does the occult really mean? Because they talk about this in the book Lords of Chaos somewhat. And their explanation was, the occult is anytime someone claims they can create their own connection to the manipulation of spiritual energy. And I was like, wow, I mean, you know, you take some time to kind of wrap your head around that, but they're talking about not anything to do with anyone, any previously established mainstream practice, mainstream that is, but once someone claims that they've developed a new way to manipulate spiritual energy, usually for a dark or malicious purpose, but not necessarily, then that would fall in the category of a cult. A specific question to Casey, said one investigator, was why? And then Royce Casey's answer was, it was to receive power from the devil to help play the guitar better. But as we also said, they did mention some things about using this as a ticket to hell. By making this perfect sacrifice to the devil, they would gain more craziness or go nuts, as he said, an investigator continued to relate Casey's comments to him. That would make them play harder, faster, and by making this perfect sacrifice to the devil, they might even go professional. Now, did they genuinely believe this? I really have to insist that it seems like they most likely did not. I mean, you really just have to think in someone's deepest convictions that they genuinely think that this would actually happen. Doubtful. Highly, highly improbable. This is instead a case of sexual domination. But I would like to add one thing. I was quite surprised when I pulled up some photos and I saw that the mugshots of these three individuals, Joseph Fiorella, Jacob DeLashman, and Royce Casey, were just in a line. I've seen videography from them before. We mentioned the show Killer Kids, and then we mentioned the podcast The First Degree. But that's a podcast, of course, hearing descriptions of what they look like, as well as seeing lots of imagery. But this was the first time that I had looked at the pictures of them, just the three mugshots right in a row. You might even be able to find this on Google Images. And the thing that I was really surprised about, or maybe just something that really hadn't caught my eye before, Joe Fiorella was the youngest at the time. As I understand, these guys were 14, 15, and 16, with Joe Fiorella being the youngest, but he's also the ringleader. And he just looks so baby-faced. He looks so small. And, I mean, especially even compared to the other two in this band, the Hatred, as you heard. So I'm just tempted to wonder if this is some type of insecurity issue that was going on with Joe Fiorella. And the reason why I composed the second upload that we did on this channel about the death of Elise Paler was the podcast The First Degree was just talking about more or less saying that murdering someone to gain musical abilities, that's not a good idea. That wasn't very smart. How could anyone believe that? And the reason I composed that upload was simply to say, they didn't. This is a case of sexual domination, and it is a driving force that you will find throughout countless true crime cases. that, you know, money, sex, and power, these are the reasons why people commit crimes. And this crime was definitely committed for sex and for power. And the boys were all sentenced to 26 to life. I mean, Joe Fiorella got the first sentence to 26 to life. And I want to say that there were some different sentences for Royce Casey and Jacob the Lashman, but those came out a little bit differently. But one of the things that I did notice from one of the other articles, it was saying that this happened in 1995, and they were convicted in 1997, I believe. So that means that 26 years is going to be coming up, so we're going to see what is going to be happening there. All that there is left to say is rest in peace, Elise Paylor. And thank you to anyone who has listened to this upload. That's all for me. Until next time.